Hi everyone, good morning. I hope, it's good afternoon, you said it right. Hi, I'm Mini Mathur and welcome to this absolutely spectacular afternoon, which I'm sure is going to give all of you a creative high and some food for thought. I, for one, am hugely looking forward to this afternoon. But before I introduce our guests, I would like to take this moment and acknowledge all of you, the media, all the influencers who joined us today, and the winners of Take 10, a short film competition that was concluded last year. And it was done to discover the next generation of storytellers. So let's hear a huge round of applause for them. And joining them are students of the Mumbai Film Academy and the Ramesh Sippy Academy of Cinema and Entertainment. So a very, very big welcome to all of you from our side. Thank you so much for taking our time this morning and being here. We want to kickstart this very, very special afternoon by giving you a glimpse into a new world created by our very own Sanjay Leela Bhansali, especially for Netflix. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing Heera Mandi. Wasn't that stunning? You want to see more? All right, bite your horses, hold your horses. But please, let's hear it for two of the most beautiful women in this room today from the cast of Heera Mandi. We've got Sonakshi and Aditi Haidri in the house. Can't wait to show you more. Can't wait to talk more about it. But we are all very, very aware that Netflix continues to work with established and upcoming talent, giving us new perspectives into innovative formats that transcend genres and languages. So today we have the unique opportunity for aspiring creative people like all of you to ask two masters about their craft, about their journey, their thoughts on creativity, on storytelling, and much, much more. And on that note, I am absolutely delighted to welcome two of the world's finest creative minds who have given us stories to remember from India and from around the world. Please welcome on stage Ted Sarandos, CEO of Netflix, and filmmaker, director, producer, screenwriter, and music director Sanjay Leela Bhansali in the house. I can see we've started the morning in a fervor and a frenzy thanks to the first look of your wonderful creation. Both of you are the creators. And I can see we've just about begun. Ted, welcome back to India.
Thrilled to be today. It's amazing.
So what is the first thing you do whenever you have, whenever you come to India on a short visit?
Eat.
All right, he's a man after my heart. All right, let's get started. Indian storytelling is what this, morning and afternoon is about. And we're having quite the global moment at the moment with Indian creators and Indian storytellers being loved, discovered all across the world. So what is it that you define as great storytelling? Ted, I'd love to know that. And what is it that makes you sit up and say, this is it, this is what I'm betting on?
You know, it's funny, it's different for every kind of thing you watch, obviously, but for me, it is a lot of, it's, do I care about these people? Am I interested in this world? Do I want to see what happens to them? And I think that's something you kind of establish early and figure out early as you're, when you're going to do a project. That's the first question I think you kind of have to answer, which I think Heramade obviously answers all those questions, yes, yes, and yes.
Ticks all the boxes, doesn't it?
Yes.
Well, you know, Sanjay, I just want to ask you, you know, Indian content is also, Indian storytelling is also on a precipice of sorts. How
so
do you,
are Indian clothes.
So are Indian clothes. To the van of born, absolutely. So what would be really interesting to know is how you decode and how you understand the audience's, you know, tastes changing today. What do you think has changed about the Indian audiences and their preferences?
Okay, first I'll answer the question you haven't asked.
Which is,
Namaste, Ted.
Oh.
Thank you for being here. It's an honor and pleasure to sit with a person with such a vision and such a great producer and giving platform to such wonderful work that filmmakers create. So you are very, very important to the whole world of cinema right now. So thank you for being here.
And kind of you, sir.
And all my beautiful people who have worked with me are here. I think they want to see me go through the grind, all that they go through, all that I make them go through every day. They want to see me trapped in this, trying to answer questions, difficult ones. And
but we gave him a day off, didn't we? Done, you're on, Sonakshi.
And then I have this wonderful Netflix team, Monica and Tanya here.
Let's hear it from
help
Monica.
Us create. But the most important person in my life is my CEO, Prerna Singh. She's very special. She's like a pillar. So she's made this happen. She'll handle Monica and Netflix. You know, they are monstrous. They are very difficult to handle.
Handled Monica. So, we will have a separate debate on that.
Yeah, so if you feel that, you know, you've got a Netflix series and all, you have to be ready to go through the grind because they are very demanding and they are... So, but she has been very, very important. All my team that is here, Arvinder, Ashna, I need to mention all of them. Chetan, who's my very favorite, Utkarsh, Amit, all of them. My art directors, those great Subroto and Amit, who've done great art and production design. So it's wonderful to be here with all of you all and celebrate this moment that is so, so very special because we've worked hard, we've gone through the grind, we've sweated it out, we've all fought amongst ourselves, we've all done all sorts of things. So anyway, now that this answer is over...
Can I repeat the question?
Please.
No, you had to, what was the question?
No, I basically want to, you know, wanted to ask you how you decode the trends and audience tastes and perceptions. And do you think we have changed as an audience?
You know, any filmmaker who says he knows the audience is living in a fool's paradise. You never know the audience. They are everything to you. They mean you are here because of the audience. Angrezi mein, Hindi mein kehte na, mai baap hai audience. We can't translate that for you in English to say, audience, mai baap hai kaise bolte.
Mother, father of
So the audience is everything to us, and to understand how they are changing, impossible. Millions of people who watch films, you can't. The filmmaker has to understand himself. He is the one who should be able to do work that the audience doesn't expect, that the audience doesn't feel that he's seen it before, they want something new. And then the filmmaker is the one who goes and changes the audience. I feel that's the way a filmmaker should believe in what he's doing, rather than worry about what they want this, then it's mathematics. Then you're setting up a project. Then I think the distributor will want this, the exhibition sector will want this, the studio will want this. How do you put all these thoughts together? You just make a film that comes to your heart. You instinctively go ahead and make it, whether people like it or not, you have to be fearless. And if it does well, you feel very happy. If it doesn't do well, you go into depression, which is good, because you get up and then again rise and make another film. But never try and understand the audience. Yes, everything has changed. Post-COVID, everything has changed. I don't know what people want. They want a spectacular film for the theater. They want very, very unusual out-of-the-box content for the OTT platforms. So their demand is really, I mean, the demand of quality that they want from the filmmaker. The filmmaker is now on high alert and he's on guard because he has to now work very hard to give a new treatment, a new subject, nuances. He demands more of the actors. Everybody has to come together and make a project. You know, people told me, Gangubai, you should not make because it's a woman-centric film, it's a female protagonist. In India, they do not go to a female subject. I mean, the box office has always never worked. And everything that, and then she's playing a sex worker, and then there is no hero. All the tick marks that you
stacked
would have otherwise
him.
Put to understand the audience that you're asking and to understand what the whole scenario is all about. Then I have ticked all the wrong boxes because, but it worked. I mean, that's the belief. That's what all the content that they are doing, The Crown and all those fabulous series that you make, they're all shockingly different. We've never seen something like this before. So the idea is the filmmaker has to believe, he has to cause the change, let the audience not change you.
Okay, so we put the, rightfully the horse before the cart and not the other way around.
Yeah, and I would say that that concentration on the audience is why I love working with Sanjay. I think his, and why his work is so amazing, because I think it is one of those things where it's easy to lose track of who you're doing this for and what you're doing it for, but you've always been very clear this is for the audience. Now, you may not understand exactly what they want, but what they want, I always feel like when people go into a movie, however they watch it, wherever they watch it, they want to, one of two things, either to escape or connect. And your work always beautifully does both, which I think is great.
I have a mini audience in my office. Okay. I'm not taking your name.
Just say it once. Because we have a code.
I have a small audience in my office who I keep showing my footage to and testing. How are they reacting? Different kinds of different age groups. So that is my test of also how the audience is going to react. By the end of it, you make a film or make a series only for it to be seen. That is your victory. And therefore, you give your best to them. But do not calculate. Do not just give them what comes to your heart and they will take it. You know? So that is very important.
So then let me ask the calculative question to you, Ted, because I really do need answers here. You know, so Netflix content has diversified across formats. We've seen you do series, we've seen you do films, unscripted, interactive, live, and now even gaming. So what I really need to understand is how do you see your audience's appetite changing? And is this in response to that? And, especially when you keep in mind some of the innovative forms of storytelling that Netflix is placing its bets on, do you take into account the audience appetite or do you also just create and...
No, it's all we think about. I mean, our entire business is built on pleasing the audience. If they like what they watch more and they don't go anywhere and they tell their friends and I think our opportunity, it feels like a responsibility as much as an opportunity to make audiences happy, trying to give them the things that they want. And the thing that they want is not always the same thing depending on what mood they're in, depending on who's in the house, depending on who they're watching with. And I think the thing that's evolved the most, and I don't know if it's necessarily COVID generated or whatever, but watching a movie at home is a different experience than seeing a movie in the theater. And understanding that, going into it and saying, what is the movie that I'm gonna make for the audience who's in the state to watch at home right now? So, meaning they're a little more distracted, they're more likely to be in control of the situation than they are in the theater where they're more willing to surrender. And that does affect how you tell a story. It does affect how movies evolve over time when they see movies like that. And I don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's just meeting the audience where they are is always the challenge of a filmmaker and a film distributor and a network to try to make people content that's suited to the viewing experience.
Which is what makes you both such a potent combination, right? You're thinking about where the audience is going and he's just thinking about what's coming out of his heart and we have magic coming out of you
right,
guys.
Right,
yeah,
right.
Absolutely.
In many ways, it's true.
Yep.
And I think what you say about the projects that come out, we make in India, last year we had 28 original projects in India, 100 so far since we've launched in India. And the diversity of the projects, I think, is what's been really thrilling. Last year we had this incredible success around the world with Gangubai, which is, I live in Los Angeles, and this is that time of year when people are talking about awards. And because people had seen Gangubai on Netflix in LA, when they saw the conversation coming around about it, they're like, oh, I saw that on Netflix, you won't believe it. You have to see it. And that whole ability to reach audience around the world is incredibly exciting. But it wasn't just that. We also had, you know, Monica, My Darling, and Darlings, Kake. Like, these projects really were enormous in India and traveled around the world, which is a really exciting time to be telling stories.
We were talking about placing bets on different forms of storytelling. It would be remiss for you, for me, not to ask you about the big bets that you always take in your storytelling. You create unique spaces, and I mean, your entire team is here. It would be silly of me to try and recreate that. But I want to know how it was for you to shift from the big screen to the digital space. I mean, did it influence your process in any way, or do you follow the same process for your films and your series? We should ask you.
I've made big films. I enjoy making those big scale films, and it comes naturally to me. But shifting to digital, I've made it even bigger. Heera Mandi is my biggest project that I've made. It's so huge in scale. I had to do something special because he had commissioned this to me, and therefore we had to do something special to make him proud. And I also made it from deep down. It just naturally came. So I did not have to adapt to for a digital medium, and for it's, I think at the end of it, you're watching a film or you're watching a series, and it has to be as creative, as intense or interesting or nuanced and well, a new treatment. The director has to give something special, the actors have to give something special. So there is no holding back or trying to think differently for the OTT platform. For me, it's making a film, and I think I've made 10 films in 30 years, and in the last 1.5 years, I think I've landed up making 3 films because it's 8 episodes, and it's like, what have you put me through, guys? It's like so demanding, it is so difficult, and you have to be so alert because there are so many tracks, and your narrative skills get very sharpened because then you're on high alert, and then you realize, God, we've missed that one shot is wrong because it doesn't show that in the other episode. So you're constantly working on a script all the time. So yes, we have to make amends as to the amount of hours we working, double the hours that I do for a film. Far more intense, far more hard work, and all of us are enjoying every minute of it. So I have given my best to this one. And I say that every time I make a film, but truly, truly this time I think I feel from deep within. I never normally talk about my work, but I feel this one is very special. It has come from deep down. And I think my dear Moeen Baig, who has come to me with this idea 14 years ago, and every time I would not make the film and go and make Devdas and then go and make Bajirao, and he would say, can you give me my script back? I want it back. I think I'm not going to make it. Give me my script back. And then finally it's gotten made. And so I think it's, once again, I only make films not with my mind and not with my craft. It's from the heart, it's from the gut. Heera Mandi has got a very, very, very special place, for I think I've done things which I am surprising myself. So before I praise myself more and give my award to me of myself, cut it short.
So have we created a series juggernaut here? Have we? Wow.
It's so beautiful. I mean, that's the exact thing when you step into a project like this is don't, you know, you said you make it bigger because the size of the project is not really the size of the screen. It's the size of the potential audience. It's the size of the distribution footprint and all that, which this is the biggest. And the it's not 90 minutes, 2 hours. It's, you know, 8 hours. It's a lot. Yeah.
And it's also the size of the heart with which he makes his film.
The size of the heart. That's
and
the
congratulations.
Key.
There's nothing better than having a script meet its, potential. So congratulations.
Absolutely.
To you. You know, Ted, a question to you. Now, you've worked with some of the most iconic global storytellers, and, Sanjay's partnership also traces back to you. It would be interesting to know what drives such sort of creative collaborations, and what is it that Netflix is really doing to nurture and cultivate these kind of, collaborations and relationships?
It's interesting when you talk about it, because in the relatively short time, we've only been making original films at Netflix for 5 years. Original series for this month was 10 years with the House of Cards launch. So when you think about the short amount of time that we've made projects with some of the greatest directors on the planet, Sanjay included. And I think about the similarities and the differences a lot. I mean, the similarities are visionary, are relentless, are people who will fight to get their vision onto the screen the way that they want it in their head, the way that they want the audience to see it, and that will never give up on the vision until it's just so. And that's true of everybody. I think the closest, I don't apologize if you don't agree, I think the comparison to, I know I've read comparisons to Baz Luhrmann with you, and I've worked with Baz. We made a series, The Get Down, a couple of years ago, and the experience has been very similar, which is that I think that this idea of, it's not style over substance, it's style and substance. And to deliver both of those things in equal measure on screen is so hard to do. And it's a very rare breed of creators who could do that. And that's what you're hoping for. So when we first met, when Sanjay talked about this project, I thought, oh, I want to see that now. I want to see that right now. And I knew from his other work that this is something that he very uniquely could bring to screen at the size and scope and scale that he can.
Oh, yes, we have only one scene, Sanjay Leela Bhansali, in our country, honestly. Don't we? You know, you've just spoken about how Hiram Mandi's an extra special project for you. What I would really like to know is how, and you know, you've chosen Netflix as its home now. 8 short films? Was it like making 8 films? Not short, okay. I heard that word short. What I really want to ask you is, how did you incubate this idea? How did it come to you? And how did you start believing that it could make a great series?
It's such a difficult sounding question. I can't incubate.
Sorry, can I break it down?
Yeah, can you make it simpler?
Okay. How did you find Hiram Mandi in your heart?
It's a broken heart, so it took a little more time to find it in my heart deep down. But yes, I think once you connect with the characters, once you connect with what his idea was, of those great courtesans who lived like queens, they had the Nawabs at their beck and call, at their feet, they had politicians, the British officers, they had lived, and they were artists, they were singers, they were dancers, they were what is the right pronunciation? Connoisseurs of good poetry and art. And so they were women that I would have liked to meet in real life. Now, courtesans don't exist anymore. With the partition and the independence and all, the Nawabs went, the monies went. So you don't get to see. So what would they be like? So that living with them for 14 years in my mind, I've made most of my films which have lived 8 years, 10 years in my mind. I would start and then I would go and make Bajirao, Devdas, all have been for a long time. And this one was for 14 years in my mind, it was there, and they never went out of my mind. So how do we give it that dignity of a world that I have not seen? How do I imagine the place which I have not seen? How do I make them act or treat or what do I do? And then I felt that this is one idea that's going to let my imagination loose. Most of the time while I'm talking to you, I'm seeing something else behind you and in front of you and around you. So most of the time I'm not really seeing things as they are. So here I had a chance to now completely take off. So I think I've lived by making a song. I started making a Tumri first because I do my own music and I liked what I made. So I said, I think now the energies are telling me I'm on the right path. And then I've cast these beautiful women, Manisha Koirala and Sonakshi and Aditi and Richa Chadda. And all these things started falling into place. We got a wonderful costume team and art direction. And I think kind of joy I had creating a world which I had not seen, but it had to look real, it had to feel real. Their angst, it was just not the dressing around that they were living in. There was angst. They had, each one had a story to tell. And we found each story, we found each one's angst and anguish, and yet they were always disguising those emotions, they were always playing up to the gallery, but heart inside all broken. So these were characters that I flourish with, I come alive with, because I am like those heartbroken, devastated person, and then you know you want to create something and you live, and these are, we are special people, we are children of a lesser God. And therefore to find those characters around and to tell a story, I mean, and it took 1.5 years to write, create everything. So have I answered your question or have I deviated
completely? No, you more than answered my question. I can, you know, ask you 5 other questions based on that. So you really do believe that you need to have a broken heart to be able to create something? You know, beauty comes out of pain?
Absolutely.
This is food for
thought. वो जो आपकी जो आपकी जो exhale होती है, आपकी जो एक आह होती है, वो तो तब होती है जब आप अंदर से टूटे कुछ anguish हुई. What is it? Ah, that is the work of creation. That is what we create. So pure artists, I feel somewhere are blessed with that pain. You can't go and say, okay, give me pain. Can I borrow it? Can I buy it? You're just born in a dark space, and you keep finding things out of it, and you want to speak and create. I like to speak through my work. I don't like the mic at all. Once in 5 years or 3 years that I
address. We're very blessed to have him here.
And then I'm sitting with a man who I think is so articulate, and so it's like, please bear with me, my conversation. I must tell you that when I was told that I have to go to LA, and if I'm there in LA, please meet him in Netflix, I need to understand who this man is, because if I get intimidated by him, then I don't want to work with him. So I went and I saw the most powerful man in the entertainment industry today was simple, so warm and so casual, and made me feel at home. And I said, this is what power is all about. When you nurture an artist, he knows how to nurture an artist, how to give him the respect for him to get the best out of him. And I said, I am making it for him. I don't care. It doesn't matter, you know. And the funny part was, and can you imagine how crazy that meeting was? I'd gone in the morning. He was launching Stranger Things in the evening.
Yeah.
And I went to his office and I was showing him on my phone. I know this is Hiram Mandi. And suddenly my driver called, Ganga. So he said, your phone. So he said, Saab, kaise hai? Theek hai, everything all right? I said, was this the only time you to talk? When I'm presenting my subject to the man, and you are now, you've come and said, are you okay? Are you all right? But then that was a meeting, it got over, he had to rush. So I thought, I called and I said, I think he has given up. I don't think it's there. But then the team and we all got together and we've made it. So so I can continue. You want to ask them?
No, absolutely not. This was most entertaining.
It is interesting how the public is so comfortable with the idea of tortured artists, but it is the heartbreak required.
Say tortured, to because we very get to see great work because of that.
Yes.
But I want to know what your reaction was.
I just want to acknowledge, but back to your earlier question, which was the detail, the amount of detail across every piece of filmmaking and series making that we're working on here. It's very rare, right? Write the music, be that involved in the set design and the costume design and the script and every piece of this. It's like, it's very, very rare. That's the, you asked earlier about what are you looking for in that. It's an incredibly rare thing.
He writes,
to see it like
he
that.
Directs, he edits, he does music,
yes.
He does
I'm
art.
I'm also the spot boy on my set. I work, I do everything.
What is it that you don't do is my question to you.
Yes.
What is it that you can't do on your set?
Yeah, cooking the meal for the unit. That's the only thing I give up. I don't.
Chalo, noted. But honestly, you know, Sanjay just said, you know, about how he was meeting the most powerful man in the entertainment business. And, you know, you have had a singularly, probably the largest singular influence on movies and entertainment across the world. And I know that the answer to this question is probably going to fill up a book. But how has the journey been for you?
You know, it's surreal. It's very surreal because I love this so much. I am a member of the audience. I'm a very passionate member of the audience all the time. So the idea that I could even be around folks like Sanjay is amazing to me every day. So for me, the personal part of that is that I always tell people, if you really want to, you know, be successful in what you're doing, make sure you're doing something that you really love. Because the hours are terrible. That's a lot of work, a lot of time. But it never feels like work if you're doing something that you love, and this is something I really love. And being able to understand how difficult it is. I mean, when you were describing the world to me in that first pitch, I'm sure 9 out of 10 places you went, they probably said, that's expensive. And you have to be able to see, yeah, that might be expensive, but it's also going to be incredible. It's also going to be spectacular. It's also going to be singular. Which is always what you're looking for, is something that is singular. So,
and would this be a good time to also ask you what the future of the entertainment industry is looking like?
Well, look, I have no more insight into the future than anybody else. I do think what is happening over time is that people The influence that the internet has had on entertainment is mostly that audiences have come to expect things like everything else in their life. When they want it, where they want it, how they want it, more control over
it. Spoiled silly.
Yeah, and I do think that this idea of walking into a movie theater and surrendering for 2 hours, as much as that is a romantic thing that I love to do as well, most people in the audience now are watching the movies for the first time at home. And when they're doing that, the dynamic is very, very different. You know, so you see a movie in the theater and it's much, much bigger than you. You're about 5'7", 5'10", 5'11". Movie's 60 feet tall sometimes. And it starts exactly what time it says it's going to start, then you better be in your seat or you're going to miss it. And you don't touch your phone and you don't talk to anybody.
Get that popcorn really fast.
Oh, definitely. And all those things are really wonderful. But the way the audiences are experiencing movies now, for the first time, sometimes they're at home and they're more comfortable, but they're a little more distracted. And more importantly, they have, at the click of a button, they can watch anything ever made. And yet they've chosen to watch your movie. And so that the audience, what we owe the audience is to, you know, make good on that choice so that they don't push that button and watch something different. And it isn't, by the way, you don't have to trick them. You don't have to make it explosive and all that. It has to be more compelling. So I think movies at home have to be more compelling than movies in theaters because the audience is a little more distracted all the time. And that's not a bad thing. You know, throughout history, we always have to kind of meet the audience where they are, and that increasingly that's where the audience is. So I think leaning into that instead of fighting it would be a helpful thing, and understand that we're all in service to the audience wherever they're watching. On whatever screen they're watching, we have to please the audience always.
That's a lot of food for thought, and I would love to get a filmmaker's perspective on it, but we keep that for a later date. Sanjeev, back to you. You know, your films have always touched on a very crucial, they always have a larger than life backdrop. They touch on important aspects of history, and yet your stories are very character focused and very human story focused. What is your process? How do you go about, I'm not asking you about your process, but how do you go about researching these wonderful worlds that you create? I mean, some of them are just so unbelievable. I mean,
when
even
you're making a historical in our country, you have to be very careful. So yes, you need to get your facts right. And that is where my research ends. Because most of it is imagination, most of it is how I see the period. I do go and see the architecture. When I go there, then I start dreaming my own extra pillars and own extra roofs and own extra carpets. So it's done, but it's not really so details of research because I find research very boring. I, as a filmmaker, am not set out to make a documentary that I want it to be exact. I want my impressions, childlike impressions, grown-up impressions, heartbroken lovers' impressions. I want all that to come into the film rather than just documented and researched. So I start with making a song. When the song falls in place, then I imagine the whole song unfold. Music is a very important part of my films. A lot of people feel that every film doesn't have to have music, which is right. I mean, there are very important socially relevant films that are made. You don't need music, but I need music. I've grown up listening to music and that's it. So if anything I need to go to inspiration for is music. So music starts, that's my research. Imagination of how that music would happen, of how this woman would look, how will she talk, what is the dialogue, is the dialogue inspiring me, are the dramatic scenes inspiring me. I feel bored about people who say, you know, we did a lot of research and we put it. It's my take on it. And they are right in the way they do it, but that's how it should be done. But I feel I just start taking off. I just start
So all those
floating.
Nuances you bring to your stories and contextualize those nuances actually are all out of your imagination.
Yeah, because if it's there real, then people have seen it. People have seen it in a documentary or in a series or something. This is what they've not seen. So what is Devdas like? Obviously, he's a literature character. But what is Bajirao Mastani like? They have not seen Bajirao Mastani. So I can take all the liberty to watch Bajirao. Because none of them have seen him, actually, because he's 300, 400 years ago. So what do I give them that makes them feel that they are seeing a film that we connect to today? This audience, as you say, has changed. 50 years ago, it would have been a different film if I had made Bajirao or Gangubai. So there is a certain modern approach to the way you make a film. The audience has to connect to it. They have to relate to this historical or a period piece. But even Gangubai, I think it was a film set in the 40s and 50s, but they related to everything. There wasn't something that I went into the exact, because I've lived in the brothels, next to the brothels, for 30 years of my life, one lane away from the brothels. So I knew in and out what those lanes looked like, smelled like, what are the faces like. So I had my research, I think, and then the rest was imagination. You can't keep going and trying to copy things and make notes. Making notes bore me completely. I'm sorry I sound like a person who film students should not listen to and should not adhere to my style of filmmaking, guys. But.
And I bet your version of 300 years ago is way more interesting than it really was 300 years ago.
Yeah, that was where I was leading. You know, he's our most treasured, you know, creative mind in our country. He's the one with the creative vision. You know, his storytelling is always something we don't expect. It's spectacular. I want to know what you think is Sanjay's unique brand of storytelling, and what's the magic that you see in his art sitting there in LA, his driver calling him.
I mean, I think I've said some of them, but I think it's that the range of the work. I mean, for me, when I think of your career, thinking about Silence, thinking about Black, thinking about Gungabai, thinking about this and the difference, they're wildly different storytelling. It's wildly different worlds that you're building out. And this ability to find that, strike that right balance between style and drama and substance and how you move a story. I think it's very, very, very unique. And but the images you put on screen and the way that they move you emotionally, sometimes it's in a tiny step in the dance, or sometimes it's in the line of dialogue. It's subtle, and it's unbelievably impactful. For as much work that goes into it, to start, you seem to invest a lot in little movements of emotion. The thing that takes you from being a little bit sad to very sad, or a little bit excited to very excited. It's a beautiful, beautiful art form. So I think that's the thing, and that comes from all that attention to detail we talked about earlier.
And from a Netflix point of view, what can we expect from Hira Mandi? I'm saying, what can we expect from Hira Mandi from a, you know, Netflix perspective, from your perspective?
Look, I think that the version, to be the clearest, cleanest version of what it is. I mean, the purest sense, in every bit of the purest sense, and that the fact that we can offer this for us that will thrill audiences in India, and for many people, it'll be the first time they see anything like this in the world. And the excitement around that we could provide is thrilling.
Great. I'm going to ask you to give us a sort of a deeper insight into the world that you're creating. But before that, Ted, I want to ask you a last question before we kind of open the floor to a lot of people here who want to ask you so many questions. So you deal with world-class storytellers, okay, people who are almost iconic in the kind of work they make. But at the same time, how do you find the balance between being a hands-on person and at the same time giving the artist his creative freedom? I mean, what is the right balance? Because you are, at the end of the day, making stories that transcend boundaries.
Yeah, I mean, I think the real art of what we do, Monica here, who heads up all of our content in India, shares this same view, this idea that basically our role really is to hopefully pick the projects and pick the storytellers and then give them the tools to do the best work of their life. And if we picked well on both of those fronts, that's really where our art begins and ends. So mostly we're here to empower, and we're here to help, because I do think if we choose correctly, the storytellers want to connect with the audience and they do want help. But I think it's very important that our creative executives are invited into the process, because they think we bring something to the process that's helpful. Not just something that says, you know, I like this and you like that. So I think that's been the thing. At the very beginning of Netflix original programming, I didn't have any staff. So we had great creative freedom, because I had no choice. I had no one to do it. But then we found that it was really helpful in that I think what artists were often frustrated by overbearing network and studio notes and overbearing creativity, really, because it's and for me, I said, let's not do that. Let's see how much value we can bring to the creator, and that's really been the cornerstone of what we do.
That's a dream association, yeah. And you know, Sanjay, you know, we've always noticed that In all your films, you have pretty iconic and strong female characters, and the stories are very often from their point of view. And Heera Mandi seems to be, you know, from their perspective. So you just talked about how the courtesans lived. We didn't know how they lived, but we would love to know more about your perception of how they did, and tell us a little more. Take us into a little bit of a deep dive into their lives.
Don't because you think you should wait for a few months to see
no,
it actually happen?
Give us a hint. Can't wait.
What is the point in telling? I cannot explain.
We're just bullying you into
they
telling us a
little more. They are such beautiful women. I feel that every woman in her life, every woman is a queen. She should be treated like a queen. Yeah, my mother was a queen. Your mother is a queen. You are a queen. She is a queen. Every woman is a queen. And these were courtesans who, behind their veils, were real women. They felt so much pain. There was so much that they went through. And yet they would come in the evening and sing and dance. Now look at those lives. They're called the courtesans. They do not have a very a place in society. Society goes to them. They please those men. They entertain those men. And they go back to their dark world. And once the prime time is over, the courtesan is dead and over, she's forgotten. So how are you going to, what about this, those jewelry that they wear and the makeup they wear and try and disguise and camouflage all the anguish that they feel? This is what is being told through the series. And these wonderful women have performed so beautifully. They're such nuanced performances. Manisha and me did the first film together called Khamoshi, which was about...
General Manisha Koirala in the house! That's silence for you. She was his first film.
Yeah, so right from my first film, where she played a strong character, where she played a daughter to hearing impaired parents who didn't want to let her go. A similar theme in Coda also. But that was 25 years ago. To Nandini, to Parvati, to Rani's character in Black, they were all strong women. I feel all directors that I have loved, Raj Kapoor, Yash Chopra, K. Asif Saab, Mehboob Khan Saab, Bimal Roy Saab, Gurudat Saab, they were all who told beautiful women's stories. They understood that she's a creator of man, and therefore she needs to be given a place in literature, in cinema, in art, in every which way. So these were the great filmmakers, V. Shantaram. They always told stories of women. They were not telling necessarily stories of men. So if there's a Bajirao, there's a Mastani also for me. So if as long as there is no Mastani, I would not make Bajirao. So as long as there is no Padmavat who holds fort and fights that war and goes into fire, I would have not made that film. So here is now, eight women who are inspiring me to say, oh, this is how you fight suffering. This is how you fight to stand for dignity. This is what dignity means to even a courtesan, even to a sex worker. Dignity is very important. That was the theme of Gangubai. So I've always granted learning from these great filmmakers and all great literature also. It's celebrating a woman, celebrating. That is, I think, the most difficult part for a filmmaker to be able to execute it. It's easy to say it. But and when you have beautiful women like and beautiful actors like that, I'm launching Sharmin into it, and she's also playing a very important part. So all these women, when they come around and perform, then they're telling something that you want to say. It's difficult. It's nuanced. I hope all that I'm bragging about right now actually reaches people and it converts onto the screen, because you're always insecure about it. A filmmaker is always insecure. That drives him to do his best, do his work harder, because will I get this right? I got Gangubai right. Now will I get Heera Mandi right? So I work harder. So what hard amount of hours I've worked in Khamoshi to the number of hours I work in Heera Mandi is tenfold more, because I want to keep giving the audience, who I love immensely, my best and more and more and more, till the day they tell me to shut up and sit down. I say, we've had enough of you. But I feel that Heera Mandi has got those nuances which you will find in the great Kamalam Rohi's Pakiza. Heera Mandi is also my tribute to the OTT platform, to those great Mughal Azam and to the great Pakiza, the great films that we made in India, Mehboob Khan Saab's Mother India. Heera Mandi will actually be that tribute to them. So,
oh my God, cheers to that. All I can say, ladies, is if there was a country for women, we'd want Sanji to be president. Really, honestly. Yeah, nobody thinks about us. This is great.
Absolutely. It's yeah. Fantastic.
Okay, so here, you know, I'm going to have, I have five or four rapid fire questions.
Still
are you game? Are there four quick rapid fire questions? Okay, well, let's just test your, you won't have to use your imagination for this one. So that's a really, you can take, give it a break. All right. For you, your stories. Okay, let me tell you that. Let me ask you first then. He's having water.
Give him some water.
You know, so you create stories that have inspired many. What inspires you? One word answer.
One. Creation.
Okay.
So something from nothing, something spectacular from your mind to the screen. It's amazing.
What is the last thing that you watched or read that you loved and felt moved by?
I'm going to give you two. Netflix picked up a film at Sundance this year called Fair Play. Earlier what I was talking about the art of storytelling and the new way of consuming, this is a movie that basically sets a hook with the audience in the first 5 minutes. The first five pages of the script took you on a ride with this couple that you're going to spend the next 2 hours with. That in the first 5 minutes you said, I am all in with these two. I cannot wait to see what happens to them. So that was really incredible. And a topic that has not been really addressed in film, so I'm really excited about that. That's a little ways off. And then on Netflix, this is not just a plug. I really was incredibly moved by our documentary, Romantics.
Because we loved it too.
I've spent so much time and energy really trying to understand the history of and the connection of Indian cinema and the Indian culture. And it really connected the dots for me in a way that I never had experienced before. And to understand, I got this understanding, if you think about everything that we do in our programming in India, just think about it even recently with things like Class that's on right now. I know there's a couple of Class fans here.
Yes, absolutely. That's what I'm watching.
Major Manjnu, the range of what's being out there. And the way that they were described was, which seemed so perfect, which is, it's like Thali is the word, right? The food. A little bit of it, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. And when you see that in many cultures, a movie has to be a drama or a horror movie or a love story or a musical. And in India, it could be all those things at the same time. And it's so cool. And it also reminded me, which was my first introduction to India cinema was Dog. And that movie for me, like I didn't know how important it was to the culture until I saw this documentary we did. I thought for me it was, I grew up in the early days of the home video stores where you'd rent VHS tapes, and every video store had a copy of Dog. I didn't know why, so probably some distribution deal somebody made. So where I grew up in Phoenix, Arizona, if you saw an Indian movie, it was probably Dog. So our documentary Romantics inspired me dramatically. So.
Amazing. And note to myself, never ask Ted Sarandos a one-word question.
Sorry. Oh, was that one?
No, right. One.
Pick any one of those words. You can pick any one of those words.
All right, then. Okay, Sanjay, I'm going to ask you the same question. What is the last thing you saw or read that inspired you or you loved?
What I read, I'm not telling because somebody will go and make a series
no,
or
no,
a
no,
film
we can't
out
have
of
that.
It. What I saw last was, I think for the last 1 month, I've been watching Hiramandi's episodes on the edit table.
Oh.
So I'm only watching that. No, seriously, I watched a film called The Banshees of Inisherin, which I was very moved by. I thought it was spectacular. And that films like that can be made today when we only talk about box office in millions and trillions. And then there is a pure film like that which comes and just touches you at the core, simple, beautiful. So, yeah.
Great. What is the best compliment you've received?
On this outfit earlier today.
Ooh.
from
yes, that's true by him. and you, Sanjay. Come on, give it to us. We need to see a side of you that nobody. We only see your work.
I still haven't received that compliment which I would like to listen to or hear or feel good. So I'll wait for it.
You get the world's compliments, and you haven't liked any.
We'll
ask you for the
say,
next series. Season
so no,
two.
Okay, now I can retire. I mean, that after that compliment.
That's one. No pressure.
Okay, this is an interesting one. This is for you, Ted, and only you. What project do you regret having passed on?
Of the ones that worked.
Good one. All right. Fair. You got to be honest. And Sanjay, this one is only for you. If you got the opportunity to remake a classic, which one would you go for?
I think Mother India, which I would refuse to make because you can't touch that film. No filmmaker should make it. But that's one film that I would like to remake. But I will refrain from making it.
All right. Fair enough. Well said. That's all that I have. I have many, many more questions. But I'm going to leave the floor open to, you know, a lot of you out here who have questions. We have mics in the audience. So let's have, you know, the mic given out to different places. We've got students, we've got media, we've got a lot of influencers, and the floor is open for questions.
Mini, hello. Yeah.
Yes.
Sorry, I'm not getting up because there are cameras behind me. First of all,
hi, Rishi.
Mini and Sanjay, I love you very much.
You got to love Ted if you love
What
us.
A wonderful conversation, Ted, and many ups to Team Netflix and Monica and Tanya to bring this conversation to us. My question is actually to Ted. You know, one is using EQ, emotional quotient, to understand what content is bingeable and what is sticky. But you guys also have a lot of data at your disposal. So what makes content bingeable and sticky? Not just with emotions, but with data, which is the new oil, all the stuff that you come together with. If you could just underline the factors, that'll help us. Thank you.
Look, I think data is a tool. It's not anything but. It helps you understand something. There's a kismet and a magic that happens in the storytelling that is not captured in the data ever. You see this and say, oh, that's going to be that. Data is very good at telling you some version of what you already did. But when you're trying to take on something you've never seen before, never recreated before, the data is of no use to you at all. I do think there's something around the thing that will people hang. You can start seeing that in big numbers when people are watching and maybe giving up on something at the same around the same time or whatever. So you can get some sense of the rhythm of the storytelling and the connectivity of that from some of the performance data. But I don't think there's anything in data that says this is going to be great. That really is still a very intuitive process between the creative executive and the creator.
So. I hope that answers it for you, Rishi. Good. Someone here.
Hi, Mini Pooja.
Hi, Pooja.
Hi, Ted. Hi, Sanjay. So the question is for Mr. Bhansali. As you said, Hira Mandi is a celebration of women, and you've got the most amazing talent onto this show. So how did you decide that these ladies were perfect for the characters you wanted?
They're not perfect for the characters at all. And because they're not perfect, it's so exciting to find and discover, okay, how are they going to interpret the role? I mean, that role could be interpreted in so many different ways, but what Manisha Koirala brings to that role, and therefore to discover the process of, oh, I have cast correctly, comes, I feel you believe it only the end. What does Sonakshi bring to me, besides her beauty and her stardom and her aura? What does Aditi bring to me? So I feel that it's to discover that it's a perfect cast as you make it. Intuitively, I've cast these women because I've always wanted to work with each one of them. And they have wonderful talent. They can do anything. I mean, you throw an ace at them, they throw two back at you. So they have tantrums. Yes, they take three hours to come out of the van because they're wearing jewelry and makeup and hair. And
mutiny in the ranks.
Then the manager comes and says, madam has to go a little early or madam has to take a day off. And you are like, can madam chill? Can madam just take a break and just go for it? But they're so lovely. When they come out, they can walk away with anything, any sin they can walk away with. Step out of the van, you're just looking at them as they walk past. Then they take the paper and they start talking and you say, oh my God, worth it. I'd wait for another 1 hour if they had took, but doesn't matter. They're such wonderful girls and I had a blast shooting with them. So no, they're not perfect. They will, by the end of the 8th episode when I finish, I will be saying that yes, that was a perfect cast.
So beautiful.
Perfect, 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 perfect.
He's made every woman in the audience want to be in a Bhansali film right now. Okay, who else?
Good afternoon, Sanjay sir and Ted sir.
Oh, right.
Hi. I'm Nupur Matkar and I'm a student of Ramesh Sippy Film Academy. My question was for the both of you is how has storytelling evolved over the years for a younger audience? And how has it been made palatable? Because now they are a big part of the creator economy on social media.
Wow.
It's a difficult question.
It's a very difficult question. We were caught napping.
Mine is same answer. So let
me. I would say the only observation of our young people, how they may have changed, is they're influenced by something different. So most of the people who work with me all grew up watching a lot of television and seeing a lot of movies in theaters. And then the generation right behind, they do both of those things, but they also spend a lot of time on social media and a lot of time with user-generated content. And so I do not accept that young people have a short attention span, because I know that's not true, because they'll sit down and binge 8 hours of a show in one sitting. So I do think the influences is the biggest change in what's it going to be like when you have spent 2 or 3 or 4 of the hours a day they used to spend watching movies and TV, watching content in social media platforms and user-generated content, and how that's going to influence the content that you create, that you ultimately create. That's probably different generation over generation.
I hope that answers your question. We have time for just one more question. And I'm happy with, who has the mic?
Hi. Yes, my name is Manisha. And I wanted to know, what are you going to do with gaming in India? I would love, if you begin that for India, and gaming. What are your plans?
So we're very early in our thing. We've created and released 50 games on Netflix in the last year, and we're going to continue to grow that. It's a very, here's my thinking about gaming, and I think it's true all over the world. People a decade from now will be spending a lot of time watching movies and television shows and playing games. I know that's true. I don't know what the mix is going to be, so we'd want to be part of the game world, because I think it's a different way of creating worlds and telling stories. And I think what we'll do in India is going to be the thing we do all over the world, is create those worlds and tell those stories that are unique and loved by the local audiences.
Wow, you'll get Hello. A lot of game heads here in India.
Hello.
It's a great,
Hello.
Great idea. We'll take one more question. Go ahead.
Hello, sir. My name is Shri, and I'm a filmmaking student. I'm from Mumbai Film Academy. My question is for both of you, that what advice would you like to tell us that for a new generation filmmakers, what advice will you give?
Just the kind of questions you love.
Using more research.
You want me to take one? I was just going to say something I said to the group earlier, which was, you live at a time, as a creator, you live in a very unique time where the tools to make and distribute films have never been more accessible and affordable and usable. They're probably in your pocket right now. You can make a movie and cut a movie and mix a movie and put it online where millions of people can see it. And that's never been the case, in the history of storytelling. So I think you don't waste it. If you think you've got an idea, try it. If you want to shoot, shoot. And try to get out there. Even if no one sees it, or even if you don't make any money, you have something you can point somebody to, and they say, what can you do? What's on your mind? What kind of story do you want to tell? And I think that's a super unique aspect of a storyteller, a filmmaker today that has never existed before. Just don't squander it. Don't squander that.
Oh my God, okay. we have a
question if you want.
Okay.
I just spoke to Aditi Rao Hedri. She complimented you, saying that you bring magic on the screen. Nonetheless, you are a hard task master. How do you elaborate?
See, we have to take one
Aditi
more question.
Is in the docs.
Should Aditi elaborate on it? Or
no,
I
no, Sanjay.
Who has to elaborate?
You tell us. आपने कहा compliment नहीं मिला आपको everybody compliments you so
There's
what
no
do you
task
have to
master and all this image that the media has built upon me and these people go and spread it to the world that I'm tough to work with and I'm difficult to work with and I'm temperamental nothing we just sit over there and find a moment that just emerges out of a conversation discussion which means I use their mind they use my mind I use the art production designer's mind I use the camera we all get together and within that idea a moment of magic comes which I then take credit for, and I say that I created the magic. But the fact is that it's everybody's mind that moment when you wait for comes after a lot of hard work and focus and commitment and conviction. So that is why they call me a taskmaster, because I won't let them go to the van till we found that moment. So that moment that we find is very precious to all of us. It doesn't come through because of me. It comes through because of everyone who works on the
Can I take one second?
Yes, absolutely.
Before we leave this beautiful audience, I just wanted to say thank you to everyone in India. You may have seen in the last couple of days, India is the fastest growing Netflix market in the world this year. And because of that, we're able to continue to invest in great storytelling. And I think when you see Hiramanda, you're going to see why it has been such the honor of a lifetime to work with Sanjay and to be able to bring this to screen. And you ain't seen nothing yet. So thank you.
One more thing. I don't want Ted to go at all to LA. Can he stay back and be in India and inspire lots of filmmakers?
Monica, let's work on that.
And not go.
Done. I agree.
Ted can stay
I second
back for
that.
All the filmmakers, for those new filmmakers, that's where you'll find your...
Ted, stay back. You ain't seen nothing yet. And I'm going to take this opportunity to thank the two of you for your time, for your invaluable insights that all of us here have thoroughly enjoyed, for that wonderful sneak peek into your mega, mega, mega show that we can't wait to see more of. Thank you, gentlemen. This has been an absolute honor and delight. And now I'm going to invite the lady of the moment, Monica Shergill, the Vice President of Content, to come close this out. Ladies and gentlemen, Monica Shergill.
Thank you, Minnie. You've been a wonderful host. Thank you for this amazing conversation with really, genuinely, I have goose flesh. You can check. I have goose flesh. So two of the greats, like Ted Sarandos, like the man of the moment, the impact he's had on the global entertainment industry is just incredible. It's so incredible to work with him as a team. And I say this on behalf of everyone, how he inspires us every single day. And really, Sanjay, I don't know how to say this, like, the absolute true visionary, the magician creator from India to the world. I cannot, and please mark my words, I have seen everything that is being created, that is being cooked in the kitchen. It's Hiramandi is going to be an absolutely special gift to the world from India. I'm at a loss for words, and I really want to call out Manisha, Sonakshi, Aditi, Shamin, Prerna, and the whole team of Hiramandi, both at Sanjay Leela Bhansali Productions and Netflix, and everyone who's put this beautiful engagement together. Thank you for coming, and because all of you have enjoyed this conversation, these insightful, delightful gentlemen who've, you know, given us so much to think about, to, you know, look forward to. I think we need to do a little something more.
Can
I No, because I'm not sure what you'll say.
Here is a lady who looks so beautiful and so gentle and so polite and so kind. She's nothing of the sort in the office. It is another game, it's another woman. Whenever Prerna tells me that Monica is coming today, I'm finding my bag to get out. I said, I don't want to deal with her. But I think wonderful spirit, wonderful kind of standing by you. What do you want? How do you want? Guiding us at the right point, telling us how the audience abroad thinks, how an audience in the other parts of the world think, and what else can they do for us. So I'm extremely grateful to you, Tanya, and of course to Ted for this very, very special moment
Sanjay,
in our lives.
Sanjay, I can say, besides your magic, you're also extremely adorable. I have to say this. And we have to, and yes, and that is true. You're playful, adorable, and I think we have to get you to make a comedy. I was sitting there and I was like, the next one has to be a comedy project, along with season two, whenever. So I think it's time to just give you guys another sneak peek, an absolutely gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous look into the world of Hira Mandi. That's a bonus, guys. So can I please ask backstage to cue the second sneak peek? Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you, Ted. Thank you, everyone. Can we have a photo op with the two of you? So we'll have one photo op, and then we'll have all of you against the outside. Against the post. We're going to take all of you guys.